We're here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight, we're tackling a combination of questions that have come from a variety of people, including best two-player games, best two-player board games, best board games for couples, two-player board games for couples, best two-person board games, best two-player board games for adults, best games for two people, board games for couples, date night games, and more.
Yes, because by far the most popular question we get asked is some variety of this, and the most popular content we produced has been about good two-player board games, in particular talking date night games. That has been the most popular thing on our blog for the entire year.
Well, this even beats out the Gloomhaven FAQ video that for some reason is still getting regular views.
Yeah, that one baffles me. Where we should do a Frosthaven one, even though we'd never even played the game, and just see if that takes off as well. So with Valentine's Day right around the corner, combined with the fact it has been quite a while since we've actually talked about two-player games for couples on the podcast, I decided now was probably a good time to do a follow-up and let you know about some of the best games my wife and I currently like to play on our date nights.
We wanted to make sure we had something current and up-to-date that not only featured some more modern games, but also highlighted games that you can go out and pick up right now. We know we're not always about the new hotness, and our lists have at times featured hard-to-find games, so we're trying to avoid that this time. Now, before we get to a list of games, let's start by talking a bit about picking the best games for date night.
So the big thing you really want to watch for when grabbing a game to bring out on a date night is how much room it takes and how long the game takes to play.
You want a game that doesn't take up too much table space, especially if you're planning on playing at a restaurant. Restaurant tables are often cluttered to start with, even before your food comes, and if you plan on snacking while you play, those drinks and apps still take up room.
And then length is important if you're planning on playing either while waiting for food or drinks to arrive, or heading out to a venue where they want to rotate the tables often. While pubs are generally pretty great about you spending hours there, as long as you keep buying drinks, your favorite dinner spot probably would rather you get in, eat, and get out.
Another thing to consider, something near and dear to my heart due to my day job, is lighting. Games with high contrast, large text, and clear iconography are often better for date night. This is especially true if you don't know exactly what your plans are. Places tend to like to dim the lights as the night gets later, and those high contrast components are going to let you keep playing even when this happens.
Now, the last concern I want to bring up, and last consideration, I guess, would be when deciding what games to grab, is volume and communication. Look at how much communication is needed to play the games you're thinking of bringing. Now, this could matter both ways, both because you don't want to be too loud in some quaint or romantic settings, or because it can be hard to play a game that requires a lot of talking and communication when the live band starts up at the bar.
Now, all of this pertains to date night, where you're going out of the house, out to a restaurant, pub, cafe, bar, winery, etc., a public place. There's nothing wrong with a night at home or even planning to play some games at home after you get back from a night out. The advantage of playing at home is you shouldn't have any of these limits.
So now that you know what to watch for when picking games for date nights, we're going to move on to some games that fit these criteria. Now, because date nights vary and different people are looking for different experiences, we've broken this list into a number of different sections based on where you may be going and what you may be doing.
Now, just a note, this is a family-rated show. So while there are a wealth of adult-oriented board games of various quality out there that may help with certain types of date night, that's not what we're covering here. Now we're going to start with quick games that don't take up much room. These games should fit on small coffee tables or a small standing bar table and can be played in between 10 and 20 minutes.
So this is where Shobu fits in. This is a chess-like abstract strategy game that doesn't need much space at all. All you've got is four wooden boards with 5x5 grids on them and 40 stones, two different colors. This is an abstract strategy game where you're trying to knock all of your opponent's stones off one of those boards through a series of passive then aggressive moves that match. Now, if you want more info on Shobu, just check out our review.
Now, you may need to watch out if one or both of you have a real competitive streak, as that may not be the tone you want to set for your date night. But for simple components that fit anywhere for fast play, it's hard to beat this one. Even spilled drinks aren't going to ruin your fun here. Stones don't care. Though I'm not sure how machine washable the rope is.
Yeah, and the rope's kind of an option. That's probably a piece I would leave at home anyway, because all it does is remind you, your first move has to be on your side. Next up, a game that kind of is a good follow-up to this is Boop. This is a board game about cats jumping on a bed. This takes up even less space than Shobu, as there's only one central board, which is a bed, which features actually a quilted playing area. Each turn, players are going to put kittens onto the bed, and these kittens boop away other kittens they're placed next to. Get three kittens in a row to upgrade them to cat. Cats can boop cats and kittens, but can't be booped by kittens. Get three cats on a row to win. Now, we've reviewed this one as well, if you want to learn more.
Now, I thought we were doing adult games. Cats and beds and anyway. While still competitive, the darn cuteness of this game really takes the edge off that. And it's not as stain-resistant for play anywhere as Shobu is, but it's still small and quick. Just beware that you might get others peeking over into your date night fun just to see what the adorable game is.
Now, Drop It has become one of my favorite dexterity games of all time, and more importantly to this topic, it's one of the few dexterity games my wife enjoys. Drop It is all about dropping different geometric shapes into a vertical tray, Tetris style. It has surprising depth due to the fact that your drop pieces only score if it's not touching anything the same color or same shape. Points are scored on how high the piece sits and if it touches bonus circles. And yep, we've reviewed this one too.
While certainly compact and resilient, one thing to think about is arm length. If you're the sort that sit across from each other, will you both be able to reach the game easily for both seeing and dropping your pieces sitting on either side of a table? Sitting on at a table corner, 90 degrees from each other, might make for easier play.
Now, another dexterity game that's great for date night would be Catch the Moon. This is a game where players are trying to reach the moon by building a precarious stack of ladders. It features a plastic base and a variety of different shaped birchwood ladders. Each turn, players roll a die, then place a ladder so it's touching one or two other ladders, or ends up being the highest point. As an added bonus for date night, this one can be played competitively or cooperatively. It's also great with up to four players as well.
And do watch out for the die on this one. It's not loud, but you wouldn't want it to go skittering off. The pieces aren't super sturdy, but that's not something I'd be worried about on a quiet date night. The co-op is tough, but it's a nice option for the date.
Now, I grew up playing Racco, and my wife and I rediscovered the game on one of our Kingsville staycations. Since Racco then, Racco has become one of our favorite date night games, especially when that date night involves some adult beverages. It's light and fast enough that you can play while just hanging out and chatting. Learn more about this classic through our review.
Now, this is one of those slightly of a step beyond standard card games. You can't play it with a normal poker deck, but it's as easy as can be to pick up. And if you're unable to count numbers for some reason, that date might have other problems.
Now, another game we discovered at the same spot is Sushi Go. Now, Sean's gone on about this one quite a bit. It was our first time playing it. It's a quick playing card drafting game that doesn't require much table space at all, especially at two players. You get a hand of sushi cards, pick one to keep, and then pass the rest on. Cards you keep become a tableau and score points at the end of the game, with each different type of sushi having its own scoring system.
While I haven't tried it two player, I've spoken at length about how much I love Sushi Go. It's just quick, easy, and fun. Well, next up, we have games with medium game time, but still not taking up much room. You're going to have a hard time fitting them in before a meal arrives, though they aren't long enough that you have to feel guilty about staying too long while finishing up your drinks.
So I'm putting Point Salad at the top of this list because its game length can range from quick to medium. Now, one round of Point Salad, we could toss this up in the last group of games, but when playing two players, the suggested way to play is to actually play the game three times in a row so you go through the entire deck of cards and total your scores. Now, you can play that one quickly. A full two-player game does make it a little longer. Now, this is a drafting game where each round you're either going to take two veggies off the table or a point card, and at the end of the game, you're going to compare the point cards you drafted to the veggies you have and score your points. Now, while we haven't tried it yet, AEG also released Point City, which is supposed to be just a bit heavier, which I got to say sounds really good to me. Now, if you do want to know more about Point Salad, you can check out our review.
Honestly, unless you hate lighter, fun games with a passion, this one is working up. For two all the way up to six players, you're just not going to regret having this one in your back pocket.
Now, the Duke is a two-player abstract chess-like game that we still play regularly on date nights. Like chess, you're trying to capture one of your opponent's pieces, with the neat thing being the pieces show how they move right on them, and after you make a move, you flip over the tile that may reveal new moves. Now, we have brought up the Duke quite a bit, and it was also on our last date night list. But since then, the game has been re-released in a new version called The Duke Lord's Legacy, which is what you can find now. This is the exact same game. It comes with everything that was in the Duke, with a new improved box, slightly clarified rulebook, the Arthurian Legends expansion, and five brand new tiles, which I'm jealous of because I don't have those. Our love of this Duke predates this whole tabletop bellhop thing, so no review to share on this one. We've been playing it too long.
I love playing this one with anyone, and while similar to chess, I think you'll find it quicker and more approachable. A two-hour or more chess match might be perfect intellectually for you, but the restaurant might want you gone long before then. Now, while not exactly quick, it's certainly faster than most heavy chess games between skilled players, while still giving you some of that feel. The random tile bag pulls might be the only thing that turns off hardcore chess players.
Zensu is another abstract strategy game. Zensu is a shogi-like game instead of a chess-like game, because shogi is basically the Japanese version of chess. This game literally puts easy to learn, hard to master on the box, which I got to say is a bit brave, because that's what people like to say about most abstract strategy games. I like the Duke. This features pieces that show you how they move right on them, but no flipping them over this time. Instead, this is a perfect information game about getting one of your pieces to the opposite side of the board before your opponent does the same to you. Now, my wife and I are still discovering Zensu, and you can look forward to a full review later in the year.
I'm tempted to call this the checkers version of the Duke, because you know everything from move one, and because of it, games will be fast. Now, I'm not sure about the 10 minutes that they list on BoardGameGeek, but maybe once it becomes second nature to you.
See, it might be that short, because I know when we tried it, Deanna fit in a full game with one of the people at Origins, did a full game with her and a demo, and I was standing watching. I don't think it took that long, so I think this one can be quick. Well, maybe it's one of those games where the more you know the game, the longer it gets, because then you're outplaying and outmaneuvering each other.
All right, well, next up, we go the opposite way with games that are quick to play but take up some room. You won't need a full table, but they probably aren't going to fail on one of those round coffee shop tables. These work well when there are only two of you at a four-seater.
Katara is a folk-on-a-map area-majority game with an Afro-fantasy theme. It's one of the few games of this genre I've found works really well with only two players. The game even includes a special smaller two-player board with less spaces on the map that physically takes up less space. Players will draft cards to determine how many units they get and how many actions they get with those units. Now, combat in this game is deterministic. The larger army pushes the smaller out. Units are never killed. They just have to retreat. Now, a bonus for this one is you can end up be able to find this one pretty cheap. It's shown up at a lot of discount outlets.
Now, this was a hidden gem game, and the smaller board means you could even package up a special two-player version for easier carrying on date night.
Now, somehow, I looked back before doing this and looked at our last time we talked about date night games, and I'm like, what the heck? How is this not on the list? We didn't have Lost Cities on there. Now, Lost Cities is a two-player-only card game that I used to play with my wife when we were actually dating, so I'm not sure how we missed it. A local coffee shop downtown had a copy. I would meet Deanna for lunch, and we would often play a round or two of Lost Cities. Now, for those that don't know it, this is an older one. I think most people have heard of it. This is a fantastic hand management, pusher luck card counting game from Rainier Nitzia.
Note, this is Lost Cities, not Lost Cities Rivals, which may sound like the two-player-only version, but it's not, and that's all I'm going to say about it. Lost Cities is a classic from a master of designing games.
Next, I have Dice Kingdoms of Valeria. It's a roll-and-write standalone game in the Valeria universe. Players roll dice and activate their citizens, similar to how resource generation works in Valeria card kingdoms. The active player then selects one of the dice to use to take an action, the value on that die showing how powerful the action is. You can explore the map, battle monsters, hire new citizens, build monuments, and more. While the game works with up to five players, it's particularly quick and tight with just two. It also doesn't need a lot of room, especially if you just use the game box for your dice rolling. This is another one you can check out our review for more info.
Tear off a few sheets, throw some dice and the cards in a baggie, and you're good to go. You can even get printable versions of the sheets online. Greet with crayons at your favorite roadhouse-style restaurant. Now next we get to the middle of the pack. These games require a bit of room and a bit more time to play. Best for a coffee shop or a slow night at your favorite restaurant where they don't mind you taking up a table for a couple of hours between playing and eating.
Kapow is a hero versus villain battling game that features customizable dice. Each player has an asymmetric player board and a starting set of dice that are used to attack, defend, and upgrade your hero. Upgrades let you gain additional dice or more faces for the customizable dice. Now, there's two versions of this, Volume 1 and 2. They're both identical, except they feature different characters.
So this one does have randomness. You're rolling dice, and that's really what you want to take away from this. It's light and competitive, but not aggressively so due to the random nature of it. Well, you know, and take that for what it is and what your tastes may be.
Next, I have Star Realms Frontiers. Now, I did call out Star Realms many times in the show, and I did call it out in our previous date night topic, but I want to call out a specific newer version. That is Star Realms Frontiers, because it includes something I think that is perfect for date night play, and that is cooperative play. Now, my wife and I still adore Star Realms, and our love for this game was reignited when we found Frontiers. You can find out exactly why in our Star Realms Frontiers review for the full story on that one.
Well, while every couple is different, I really prefer co-ops for this sort of night. We can have enough conflict in our daily lives, and often date night is to escape that. A nice co-op is a wonderful way to have that shared bond with someone. The sci-fi theme and fantastic combo system of this one is just an extra bonus for me.
Sticking with cooperative games, we've got Illiterati. This is a word-building game that I like to think of as Bananagrams for hobby gamers. Now, I'm calling it out here mainly because we had Bananagrams on the last list, and I still stand by that. It's still a good two-player game. The problem is, though, when your skill at word games is unbalanced between your couple, that's what Illiterati fixes. In Illiterati, players are rogue librarians trying to save the world's books from the evil Illiterati, which is a fantastic theme. Now, my wife is really good at word games, and that usually means it's no fun for me to play against her. With Illiterati, though, her skill just means our team does better together.
The word game for couples who hate playing Scrabble. I think a lot of couples have this imbalance, and this levels the playing field as well, lets you not only make words, but use some of your knowledge as well, with some of the requirements balancing spelling knowledge from one player and knowledge of some possibly obscure topic, like names of tech companies for the other player.
That leads me to Dolce. Which I didn't know the term for this until just end of last year. I learned people are calling these bingo games. That's where you have one input and everyone uses the same input. And you end up with a different output. This is an engine building game about building a confectionery empire. Every round, everyone has to decide what to do with the same building. They can build the building, they can flip it and use it to plant ingredients, or they can discard it in order to produce ingredients and hopefully produce some desserts. While many people have called this multiplayer solitaire, and I think rightly so, they're not wrong, that's actually what makes this work great with two players.
This is one where you want to have good light. If you're playing this in a very atmospheric location, you might struggle with some of the symbols. I know I did in good light.
Yeah, that's a good call. I hadn't thought of that one when putting that on the list. Next, I have a game that is brand new for us that I just got for Christmas, and that is Disney Lorcana. This is a Magic the Gathering style two-player dueling card game featuring characters from all over the Disney universe. Now, it's a bit less confrontational than most collectible card games, with players racing to be the first to get the 20 lore. Now, the downfall here is, of course, the entire collectible aspect, but we've been having a great time just battling with the preset starter decks with each other.
So pick up a couple of starter boxes and just play. Maybe you'll get into the collecting, maybe not. But the starter decks are all you need for a night of fun play. Two boxes give you everything you need, including starter guide, playmat, and tokens. Now, here are some games that need a good-sized table. They either have central boards or require a larger playing area for each player. These are too big for most restaurants, but do work at some pubs and cafes with larger tables that aren't overly busy.
So one of our strongest recommendations for two-player games, and every time I talk about two-player games, I like to bring up Race for the Galaxy. It's still one of my favorite two-player games of all time. But now I want to follow that up with a new recommendation, and that is for Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition. This is the game you get if Terraforming Mars and Race for the Galaxy had a baby. It features a much smaller map of Mars, an action selection system that's almost identical to Race for the Galaxy, but still features all the tableau-building goodness from Terraforming Mars. And it plays in about an hour, which makes it a much better date night game than either of the originals.
Notably smaller than Terraforming Mars, but with so much of what you love from that original, minus some of the length. Still not a quick game, but it's shorter than many, if not all, games of the original. Now, one thing to note is that there's somewhat less player interaction in this version, which is good for this list, but might turn off some people who love their hate drafting.
Next up, I have Disney Sorcerers Arena Epic Alliances. This is a two-player card-driven skirmish war game that lets you battle your favorite Disney and Pixar characters. Each player builds a team of three characters, each of which has its own deck of cards. Mash those together and take the battle to the arena using some of the best-looking standees I've seen in a game. Despite the Disney theme, this is a very solid tactical and strategic skirmish game that is both approachable enough for new players and deep enough for hobby wargamers. All of that with no miniatures to assemble or paint, thank you. So far, we've reviewed everything that's been published for this game, and every review has been positive.
The only thing I would say for this is, if you're a collector of it, it's a lot to carry around. You might want to pre-draft and just bring what you need in one box, rather than trying to bring the whole collection. Sadly, there are no first-party solutions to store this game and its expansions.
Now, for this section, I saved the Castles of Burgundy for the very end, because when you first pick up this game, like many Steffenfeld games, it can take you a long time to play, especially when learning the game. That said, once you and your partner know the game and you no longer have to look up what specific building tiles mean in the rulebook, it can play very quickly and very smoothly. Even better, there are now multiple printings of this game, including a super deluxe edition. But whatever version you choose, The Castles of Burgundy is still, in my opinion, one of the best two-player games ever published.
Space and good lighting are your friend on this one. Playing it in person means you lose the ability to get mouse-over information like you do on Board Game Arena. Now that leaves us with the final part of our list tonight, the chunky games. This final list of games are the ones that you're probably going to save for a stay-at-home date night.
Yeah.
Perhaps something you return to after a nice dinner out, or something to play after dinner at home.
Now, personally, my wife and I like to pair these with some homemade charcuterie and craft beer. That said, I've actually played two of these games at a coffee shop, one that didn't mind us spending the afternoon and putting some tables together.
Also, be aware that the first three games mentioned here are on the heavier side and aren't going to be everyone's idea of date night fun. Not everyone is like Deanna, who enjoys some brain burn with her board games. These are generally going to be for your date nights at home or when you get home after dinner and can take the time.
So Tapestry is one of my wife's favorite games, and it plays surprisingly well with only two players. You can play this anachronistic civ building game as a head-to-head battle, or if you want to make things even more interesting, you can toss in one of the Atoma, which makes the game actually more cutthroat. Now, I will admit, I do prefer this game with more players, but I love the fact that if it's just Deanna and I, we can sit down to play one of our favorite games. This is another one you can learn more about if through our Tapestry review.
The dripping asymmetry of this one is certainly a huge bonus. This game is probably the most controversial game that we talk about in general. People either love it or hate it. And honestly, I think both sides have some solid and justified arguments. This is the first step down a path of multiplayer solitaire, as it does feature a little area control map combat, but very little.
Now, the hot game in our house right now is a huge box you can see behind me, and that is Marrakesh. That is from Screen Game Steffenfeld City Collection. It's actually the first brand new game in the series. This is a very component-heavy Euro game that's for longtime Feld fans and experienced gamers. Please don't make this your first Feld. Despite the fact we have played this on a date night, had a coffee shop, and tried to set it up upstairs at a brewery, you're probably better off playing this one at home. Even if it's only due to the fact there are so many tiny little components, gates and keshis and tokens, and there are no spares. I fully admit, this game is not going to be for everyone, but this is a list of the date night games my wife and I enjoy. This is a beautifully juicy point salad with a ton going on, but only a limited option tree, which helps keep the game manageable. If you're considering leaving the house for this one or have a smaller gaming table, what you could pick up is the Essential Edition. While you didn't get all the cool bits, it does take up less space. Personally, I'm happy having the big one.
This one is hefty in more ways than one. I would say that unless you are both familiar and confident in your knowledge of this game, don't bother. But if you already love the game, then the lack of direct competition aside from some drafting makes it great fun for a couple.
Next, I have the hybrid deck building and worker placement game of Lost Ruins of Arnak. This is a favorite in our house and has been since we first picked it up. We love playing this at all player counts, but noticed it's particularly engaging and cutthroat at just two. There's a real rush to try to buy the good cards or advance up the tempo track or defeat the right monster or explore the perfect area before your partner can beat you to it and get that thing they really want. The thing is, in Arnak, there are so many different paths to victory that getting cut off in one direction doesn't ruin your chances of winning in any way. There's always another probably equally valid option available. This is another one. You can check out our review for more info.
When you're both using the same board and drawing from the same market, it's really very much each player playing their own game, which could be a bonus or a negative depending on who you are and what you're looking for. What you're getting either way, though, is a great midweight game.
Now, the last game on my list today is HeroQuest, and I'm putting it here because it's a game my wife and I played through when we were dating. I took on the role of the evil Zargon, and my wife played all four of the characters. We played through the entire campaign as our relationship grew, so this game will always hold a special place in my heart. Now, we haven't called out HeroQuest in the past because the game was out of print for years, lost in the world of red tape and copyright. This has since changed. Hasbro, through their Pulse crowdfunding thing, has published a brand new version of HeroQuest, which features the same gameplay but updated artwork and components. In addition, this is the part that's most impressive, they continue to put out more content from the game. And now there's more available for HeroQuest than there ever was before.
Maybe you too can cement a relationship through shared dungeoneering battles with your partner. Stranger things have certainly made for lasting relationships, and no one gets hurt but the orcs and demons.
So there you have it, an updated list of great games for two-player date nights covering a wide range of time, space, and player skill requirements. Is there something on the list we missed? A game you and your partner just love to share together when out? Let us know in the comments or join us at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and chat with the community.
And now a word from our shiny new sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
So in the next segment, we're going to be reviewing The Cupid Crisis, the fourth game in the highly acclaimed Holiday Hijinks series, which has a Valentine's theme, and it would also make a great date night game. But there's another holiday that hits before then.
Punxsutawney Phil needs you. On a cold February morning, you find yourself trapped in the professor's manor, faced with the results of his experiments with time itself. Can you break the loop and escape? It's time to get your groundhog on. The Groundhog Gambit, that is.
The Groundhog Gambit is the seventh Holiday Hijinks game, and no, you don't have to play them in any order. They're all standalone games. It packs a full two-part, two-hour escape room experience into just 18 cards. That's double the length of all the other games in the series so far. You can pick it up as a single game, a print and play, or part of a bundle at grandgamersguild.com.
And don't forget to use our exclusive code Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to save 10% off any order you place through Grand Gamers Guild.